All right, great to be with you today. We spent a little bit of time in the book of Revelation, and you know, really the heart behind that was to go through the seven churches in Revelation. We looked at a couple of songs, you know, in the early chapters of Revelation. We're going to turn our attention now to the book of James. And James is one of my favorite books in the Bible, partly because James is a bottom line kind of guy. And I appreciate that about him for sure. James, as some of you probably know, was a half-brother of Jesus. He grew up in the same house as Jesus did. I don't know what that looked like. You know, how hard would that have been for all the kids in that home to have a perfect, literally perfect older brother? But I know there was a lot of grace there as well. He was not initially believing. You'll probably remember the stories of Mary and the siblings of Jesus coming to the house in particular, wanting Jesus to come out. Jesus responded and said, "Who is my mother? Who are my brothers and sisters?" And then he looked at his disciples. And so it was a long road of really coming to a place of faith for James. According to 1 Corinthians 15, Jesus actually gave James a personal resurrected appearance. Yeah, this probably had an impact on James and led him to faith. You know, after that moment of really investing his faith in his half-brother, older half-brother, as Savior and as Lord, you know, his life was radically changed from that point on. And very significant figure in the early church. He was a man of prayer. They called him Old Camel Knees because his knees were so calloused from going consistently to God in prayer. Had a very significant role in the church in Jerusalem, and you know, was a very dedicated disciple. And you're going to see that in this epistle. A lot of challenges from James, you know, not to be half-hearted in our approach to God, but to really call ourselves disciples, to really live like that. So I believe that this short study, you know, as we're kind of working our way through devotionally, this epistle is going to have a great impact on your life. I'm reading from the Old King James, the Authorized King James Version. I have a good friend who gave me a Bible recently. It's a beautiful Bible. And I love the Old King James. So if you're okay, hopefully you're all right with this, I'll be reading from the Old King James. Chapter 1, verse 2 says, My brethren, count it all joy when you fall into diverse temptations, knowing this, that the trying of your faith worketh patience, but let patience have her perfect work, that you may be perfect and entire or complete, wanting nothing. James starts his epistle out with a challenging encouragement, and he was writing to a group of churches. It was a broad epistle written to. It's for sure relevant for all Christians, but there was a particular group of people he was writing to who were going through hard times. Very difficult times, probably challenges that they didn't expect they were going to be going through. And so some of them may have been taken by surprise, but he gives them great counsel in the midst of severe tribulation. It is a timeless word and one I really want to encourage you with today. He says, count it all joy when you encounter, the word fall here can be translated encounter, diverse temptations or different types of tribulation or challenges or adversity. So, you know, he's got a really different perspective, because I think a lot of times when we're thinking about tribulation and difficulty, we don't necessarily do the math and come to the conclusion of joy. When he says count it all joy, the word count is a mathematical term, and that's exactly what it means. He says do the math, work the equation. And then what you'll notice as you put all the different variables together is that they should equal joy for you. What a wild perspective to have on tribulations. And I think it totally, legitimately begs the question, why in the world should we do the math when we're going through circumstances that are hard and come to the conclusion that these things should produce joy within our life, right? The settled state of confidence, contentment, and hope in God, that's what joy is. Well, he answers that in verse 3. And he says, knowing this, so our ability to come to the conclusion that difficulty should bring joy to us is based on something that we know. It's not conjecture. It's not just an opinion, you know, that somebody has. We know these things. What is it that we know? We know that the testing of our faith, that's what's happening when you're going through difficulty. It's not that God's out to get you. It's not that God is trying to just make arbitrarily life difficult for you. It's not that the world is just against you. It's that there's something that's happening in particular with respect to your faith. Your faith is being tested. And it's not like a pass or fail type of thing. The word test means to be refined. God is doing something to your faith relationship with Him, which matters more than anything. So the refining of your faith, this is what it does. It produces or it works patience. It leads you to a place. As you grow in your faith relationship with God, you become less impatient and you become more patient. You become less impatient and you become more patient. That's convicting. I don't know while I say that. I didn't plan to say that. But as I say it to you today, I'm a little convicted myself. Why is it that as we grow in our faith relationship with God, why is it that when our faith is being refined and that means that the impurities are being taken away and our faith is being made more perfect or more mature, why is it that we're less impatient and more patient? We've learned to trust God. We've learned that God always comes through. We've learned that God is consistently faithful in our life. So we don't just have to react to things. We don't have to be caught up in emotion. We don't have to be driven by our feelings. We can rest assured that God will always come through. There's a growing patience that God works with in our lives. But that's not it. Let patience have her perfect work, that you may be perfect and complete, lacking nothing. So as you go down this road, this is how it kind of works. Difficult circumstances, choosing to consider it joy. Why? Because I know what the Bible says. And the Bible says that in the midst of hardship, God is doing something to my faith. What is it that He's doing? He's refining it. He's purifying it. He's addressing the areas of weakness, the inadequacies in it, showing those things to me so that I can confess them to Him, repent of them, and choose to walk in more mature faith. As that process goes on, I'm not predisposed to be impatient. I'm more patient because as this happens time and time again in my life, what I see is God always comes through. And as I let that process work, like this is the process God has us on, as I let that process work, I become a spiritually mature person. My growth is not stunted because I've chosen to walk in the flesh. I have grown spiritually because I've chosen to walk in the Spirit. I want to encourage you with that word today. Like, this is where we're at right now. And you might be thinking, man, what in the world is God doing? That's what He's doing. That's what He's doing for sure. If you let Him, God wants to refine your faith, produce patience in your life, lead you to a place of courage and strength so that you walk strong as a mature believer in Jesus Christ. Father, thank You for Your word today. We pray, God, that this word would really bless us and strengthen us and help us today in Jesus' name. Amen.